Hey, this is Bjorn Rebney, CEO and Chairman at Bellator MMA. You're watching ProMMANow.com.
This is Dr. Ruddy Ferguson of ProMMA Now. I am here with Bjorn Rebney, and I want to speak about something that's kind of tangent to what's been going on in Bellator, but a big theme in the sports of mixed martial arts. We've gone through the Hector Lombard, we went through the Carl Parisyan during this time in a previous organization. We've gone through the Ronda Rousey emergence, and right now it seems that throughout the different timelines of the sport of MMA, judo seems to make its way into the mainstream. And right now on your next show in New Jersey, you're gonna have two of the headliners, the former guy who was the name that was on everybody's tongue when it came to judo, and the current male in the sport who's on the name of everybody's tongue and when it comes to judo, and who was my Olympic teammate, Rick Hawn. What does that mean for your particular organization? Because I know what it means for the sport of judo.
Yeah, you know, I mean, it means big things. It means big things. I mean, there are those guys who come up. Carl was that first guy that came up, and Rick, at an Olympic level, came up, and it's also, I mean, both of those guys have utilized judo and integrated into their MMA game to great success, to great levels of success. Caro has had, obviously, as well documented issues, but from everything that I've heard has, and from everything that he and his management have told us, is in as good a place as he has been in a long time, and his back in training and hyper focused and has been in that domain, in that world for about a 90-day period leading up to this fight. So in a perfect world, from a judo fan perspective, we would get to see the best of Rick Hawn, who has been training ever since the loss in the world title fight against Mike Chandler, and the best of Carl Parisyan together. And that would be an old guard and a new guard coming together representing judo in a spectacularly high-level way. So I'm excited about it. I think it means a lot for the game. It's going to be a big fight on a huge card on Spike Network. And, of course, both of these guys made their name vis-a-vis that sport. So I'm excited about it. I mean, I'm excited to see it. I'm excited to see how those two kind of counter each other and what ends up happening in the fight.
Well, tell us this, because a lot of people in the sport of judo follow Carl Parisyan, and we followed his time in the sport when he first started. He was at his pinnacle, and we followed the time when he's making his reemergence or his comeback, if you will. What made you, as the CEO, take a risk on a Carl Parisyan if you felt that it was a risk or an investment?
We did. And you and I have talked about in the past, we do a lot of due diligence. We do a lot of checking on things before we dive into pools. We don't simply go, oh, you've got a great name and it would be great to have Hawn versus Caro in terms of judo versus judo. We did a lot of checking. We did a lot of talking. We talked to him. We talked to his management. We wanted to really kind of do a deep dive into where he was, because he has had well-documented issues. He'll be the first one to talk about it. And we were comfortable enough with where he was that we felt it was a good investment of time, energy, and money to put that fight together. And we felt like he could hold it together.
Is this a one-off for him, or is it a contract deal?
Well, you know, we have the opportunity to work with him moving forward. We'll see how the fight goes. You know what I mean? I mean, he's, you know, people forget he's only 30 years old. I mean, he's not, you know, this is not a guy who is looking to make his last comeback into the cage. This is a guy who's been sidelined and burdened with issues that are not related to age or the degradation of his body or the fact that he just doesn't have it anymore. He's had other demons. If he can get rid of those, I mean, Carl was fought at a very high level for a period of time, a very high level. A lot of people forget about it because they think about the bad things that happened to him. But if he can come back, you know, this could be an amazing fight and it could be a great rebirth for him.
I've talked to one of my Olympic teammates, Taraji Williams Murray, who lives in that New York, New Jersey area, who's coming to the fight. He's a two-time Olympian. I understand that Kayla Harrison is coming to the fight. She's the recent Olympic gold medalist, our first Olympic gold medalist in the sport of judo. I'm coming to the fight. We got Rick Hawn, who's an Olympian, who's going to be at the fight. And then we have Carl Parisyan, who made his name in judo at the fight. You're going to have a lot of judoka in the arena that evening. And as judo players, we have talked about Bellator, and we appreciate the opportunity for you to actually showcase our sport and allow us to, you know, also combine some of our marketing opportunities and efforts with what you do with Bellator in order to grow our sport. Because I'm sure you're familiar with wrestling's unfortunate situation of being removed out of the Olympics.
Yeah, I will. one of the, you know, look, I try to stay kind of calm about it, but one of the arguably the greater travesties that I've seen of late would be with the IOC. I mean,
right.
Yeah, I mean, it just, it is, it's hard to conceptualize. If you said it, you would, if you said it and you didn't know that it was real, you would almost think it was a joke. If you look back at the history of the ancient Olympiad, wrestling was one of the first two sports in the history of the Olympic Games. Wrestling has been interchangeable with all things Olympiad since the very birth of the Olympic Games in ancient Greece. I mean, wrestling is, there are a lot of sports in the Olympic Games, and I have great respect for any athlete from any country who puts in the time, energy, and money, he or she, that is necessary to put in that kind of commitment to get to that level. If you're an Olympian, no matter what the sport, but to think about the removal of a sport like wrestling from the Olympic Games, and particularly, obviously, I take a heightened interest in it because wrestling feeds more athletes to mixed martial arts than any sport on earth. I mean, you and I are talking hardcore about judo and the impact that it has in terms of a Rick Hawn and a Caro, et cetera. But there are countless wrestlers who transition from that game into this game, from an NCAA level, from an Olympic level, et cetera. And to take that away, to take wrestling disassociated from MMA, to take wrestling out of the Olympic Games, it would almost be as if someone had said, you know what, we're going to take the marathon out of the Olympic Games. We're going to take the 100-yard dash out of the Olympic Games. Inconceivable to me. And my hope is that we're going to be able to work with USA Wrestling, with Jim Rabinack, and with the team there to be able to really heighten awareness amongst people who just watch the Olympics and just assume that wrestling will be there as to what's going on, because this is something that really shouldn't and can't happen. And if it can happen to wrestling, it can happen to any other sport in the Olympic Games.
Definitely can happen.
Oh, it can happen to judo at the drop of a hat. I mean, if you are a hardcore judo fan, you should be on heightened alert, because if they can do that to wrestling, they can very easily do it to judo. There's really no sport that would be untouchable if you could do it to wrestling. So, you know, I mean, it's time to take action. It's time to kind of marshal every conceivable resource, talk to sponsors, take action, and move through whatever mechanism USA Wrestling guides us to move through to try to change the direction of a vote that will ultimately take place in the latter part of summer, beginning of fall, to ultimately make that final determination. But we should do everything we can possibly do to ensure that doesn't happen.
Well, thank you so much for your time. I just want to end on one final note. The last time I spoke with you, we were not all on Spike. We were getting ready to be on Spike.
Great.
How has the transition been to Spike?
Oh, it's been great. I mean, you know, for somebody like me, somebody like you, who's been watching MMA for a while, to be, you know, Bellator live on Spike 25 Thursdays out of the year at 10 o'clock in primetime, you know, sometimes I got to kind of pinch myself and say, hey, this is really happening, and the numbers really are there, and we're putting a lot of butts in seats in arenas, and it's working. It's great. You know, I mean, the best thing about it is that the brain trust of people who work at Spike love mixed martial arts. They know the game. They know the guys who are fighting on Spike.com. They know Carlo's background and where he came from and what he accomplished in judo and what he did at the other organization. They know Rick Hawn. They love the game and they live in the game. So to be able to work like that, I mean, you surround yourself with people like that, it just heightens the organization, the live event experience, the televised event experience. You know, it's the best partner. I said it to you when we were talking about getting ready to move to Spike, and I can say it to you now that we are on Spike and have done, you know, our 11th show, working on our 12th. These guys are the best that exist in televised mixed martial arts, televised combat sports for that matter. So it's been great.
Well, Bjorn, once again, thank you for your time. This is Dr. Roddy Ferguson of Pro MMA Now, and I DVR Scandal, but I watch Bellator.